All right. Hi, everybody. Welcome to Burning Hot Events' first Zoom interview. We'll call this Burning Hot Interviews. I'm here with Robert Wax from Crashing Cairo. Robert, how's it going today?
Fantastic. Fantastic.
Excellent. Glad to talk to you. All right. Now, I know the band is from Detroit. Are you from Detroit? Are you Detroit native?
We're all Metro Detroit natives. You know, Detroit kind of has a tri-county area, Wayne, Oakland, and McCormick. And it's kind of a sprawling area. And so we all have lived in lots of locations in and around Detroit.
Excellent. Well, I mean, I'm just asking because I knew you're from, you know, connected to Detroit, and I was kind of curious if you're from there. So all in the area. And just what I was curious about is just because Detroit has such an incredible, expansive musical history. I mean, proto-punk, like the MC5, the Stooges are from there. You have Motown. You even have stuff in the last, you know, 20 years, the White Stripes, the Detroit Cobras, stuff like that.
Right.
And I was just wondering, like, you know, did the sort of musical heritage of the area, was that an inspiration to you when you were starting out?
You know... Motown, I think everybody can relate to. So I grew up knowing that Motown was from Detroit. So that I think would be very pervasive. I can't speak for the rest of the guys, but I would say that growing up, I gravitated to a lot of music from the UK.
Right on. That kind of goes right into my next question too, because moving beyond Detroit, what were some of your influences early on and the stuff that kind of made you fall in love with music?
Well, let's see. I'll go back a little further back than me, because I actually really liked the Beatles growing up. My parents had Beatles records, and so I wanted to know about this, right? You know? Mm-hmm. And, I remember when I was in high school, I discovered a bunch of 45s, you know, the smaller ones.
Oh yeah, yeah.
And I was sick. I think I had mono, and I was sick in high school. And so I was home for a week, and I found all these trim nails. You know, this like short little trim nails.
Mm-hmm.
Covered my wall with these nails and hung all these 45s up on my bedroom wall. So, you know, my first dive into music wasn't even music from my generation. It was music from my parents' generation and, you know, grabbing these 45s and trying to make them work and that. And so that was how I started out. And so I remember songs like Revolution,
mm-hmm.
Really striking a chord with me. There was a level of energy there that I just was really just pulled to, you know, and you know, David Bowie and all of that. I'd say that it all started with the Beatles, David Bowie, and maybe some Queen in there, right?
Yeah. Well, that's something we have in common, because my introduction to music was through my dad's record collection, and he was a big British Invasion guy, especially the Beatles. Like, my dad is a guy that if you say the Beatles aren't the greatest rock band of all time, he's going to argue with you until you admit they are.
Right, right.
So, that's fascinating. Now, you brought up Revolution. That's on the White Album. Were you a later Beatles era, or are you like a lot of fans just all across the different albums?
I'm all across. And I'll say, not that Paul McCartney didn't do a great job, mm-hmm. but I gravitated toward the Lennon stuff more.
Yeah.
I don't know why. Not that Hey Jude isn't great, or, you know, that was on the flip side of on that 45. You had Revolution on one side and Hey Jude on the other.
That is exactly right, because I had that 45. I know exactly what you're talking
about. With the apple.
Yeah.
Oh yeah. See, I got into all that stuff, and so I gravitated toward the Lennon stuff a little more, but you know, and then I got into bands, you know, like Unforgettable Fire by U2. I thought that was just amazing stuff. Like, I thought that was, to me, just something really unique. you know, that I discovered that. And I've always been kind of someone that goes way back in music, you know. I don't know why, but I've always been behind the curve, right? Mm. I've always been looking back instead of, you know, if you name bands that are current right now, for my entire life, I've been stuck. And I've always looked back, and I don't know why. I mean, everybody's got their own way of approaching music, but that's just the way that I've always run myself. So.
But, you know, like, I think people always say, they use that phrase, late to the party. I don't think there really is a late to the party. I think when you discover something in music, that was probably, okay, it came to you at the time it came to you.
Right, yeah.
And
yeah.
That's great. Now, just because you brought up U2, that's an interesting little transition because, you know, like me, you start out with kind of the music your parents list to, a lot of British Invasion stuff, UK music, mm-hmm. Even going into Bowie. So was U2 your first kind of breakout on your own? Like this was something you discovered independent of music you're listening, you know, you knew from your parents?
Let's see, what would be? Yeah, U2, you know, as a kid, you know, discovering this band, right? They you need to remember that since I was, as you put it, late to the party, you know, I was listening to U2 when everybody was kind of saying, oh, there's this huge mega act U2. And I wasn't even listening to the mega act stuff. I was going back a couple albums, right? And so you know, but that was like, I'd say that was my introduction to, it's still pop, but it at the time, it wasn't classified as pop. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Yeah, at least the stuff I was listening to wasn't.
Well, especially with U2, because when they, I mean, yeah, by the time they became like superstars playing stadiums and all that, but I mean, the early U2 records were, you know, they were not like a stadium friendly sound or anything like that. Like they were some kind of smaller.
You know, what's crazy is that you're right. Although I've seen them perform those songs in a stadium and then they hold up. They just are, you know, now I'm not talking about like Boy and War and some.
Yeah.
I'm talking about some of the, you know, like Pride and stuff like that. There are some songs that are just like, whoa, gosh. So I really think that, you know, they were before their time, if you know what I mean. Mm-hmm. But I mean, who's to say, because they, you know, became this huge band. Now, well, you know, I'm a U2 like groupie, but
and they have like their catalog is so expansive, and yeah, like it's, they're a great band to go back and discover those new albums, especially if the, you know, you around the time they were getting huge. I had a very similar relationship to like REM.
Oh yeah,
like. I remember when REM was blowing up really huge with like Automatic for the People. And I just was a kid and I was going to a record store and I was like, hey, where are your REM records? And I was like, oh, they've had these used, so I'll just buy these. So I was getting all the, you know, IRS era stuff.
Uh-huh.
And I was like, this stuff's incredible. Like, why isn't this getting played? And yeah, like, so it was kind of like, yeah, I sort of moved backwards with like bands. And you know, sometimes that's just our relationship to music.
Yep. But then I went from U2 to Radiohead.
And yeah.
Just, you know, that just for me was, oh, this, you know, is huge, you know, like, gosh, you know, I think I've liked every album by Radiohead, you know.
I love Radiohead because they're a great example of a band that never seems to recycle anything. Like you never get a new Radiohead album. You're like, this just sounds like the old one.
Right.
Like yeah. Every Radiohead album is like, oh, wow.
Yeah,
you know, took this someplace new. And I mean, I think too, when Pablo Honey, that first record came out and Creep was a hit.
Yep.
And I remember getting that record and then the Bends came out and I was like, oh, cool. We got Radiohead. And like, it was like hearing an entirely new band. Like, what?
Right. Big guitars and everything, right?
Yeah. It just blew me away. And then OK Computer and then Kid A and the whole, they just kept kind of every time just doing something new.
Yeah, and then I went into, and I'm just talking about me. I could
talk
about David's influences, Joel's influences. Mm-hmm. David plays drums.
Yeah.
Joel plays the guitar, and Chris plays the bass. And each of them bring, you know, we're only talking about my influences, but you know, they have these influences, and some of them are really interesting competing influences that happen. And that's how we kind of reach where we're at. After that, I went into the National and I really liked them.
Yeah.
I like them. I shouldn't say past tense, but yeah, I think that they're really a neat band.
Yeah.
And that brings me to today. And where am I at today? Well, I could look at what I listened to on Spotify recently and tell you in the moment.
Yeah.
Let's see. The Black Angels. Do you know them?
Oh, love the Black Angels.
Yeah.
Great band.
You know, I'm just looking at, you know, Tame Impala.
Mm-hmm.
Inhaler, which is kind of funny because Inhaler, Bono's son, is the lead singer of Inhaler.
I did not know that. I didn't know that. I know of Inhaler. I didn't know that was his son.
Which is funny, you know, like, I mean, but it's really good. It sounds, you know, because I ran into it and I liked it. And I was like, this sounds like old U2, you know, like old, early 80s U2.
Yeah.
You know, like it's brand new stuff by these young kids. And then I looked into it and Bono's son's lead singer, but I don't know. There's a bunch on here. But
yeah. And you know, like it's, and now I'm getting that point, but as far as like my relationship with music, where if I discover anything that's new, like in the last 5 or so years, like, oh, that was great. There's still all this stuff out there that's,
yeah,
that's cool.
It's neat to go back too. It's neat to grab a band and then go back to the beginning and see that growth.
Yeah. Just dig back into the catalog. Now, I mean, moving from music, being a music fan, into playing music, when did you get into playing music? Like, what inspired you to first, like, this is something I want to try to do?
When I was 6 years old, my parents took me to a concert at a local amphitheater. Mm-hmm. This is a 15, 16,000 person amphitheater. It's a big outdoor amphitheater.
It's
famous in the Detroit area. It's, the name of it's called Pine Knob. And Pine Knob Music Theater has been around forever. And I went there and my parents took this little kid to this loud music. And, you know, I remember tears were coming to my face. It hurt so bad, but I was having a blast. So I had a smile on my face. And at one point, they were very close to the front row, second row or something like that. My dad, I guess being a bit of a hippie, holds me up in the air and the lead singer grabbed me and took me up on stage for a moment and sang a, like slowed everything down and sang a quiet song about a little boy, right?
Yeah.
And then that was when I was six. And for about a year, I thought that that guy was really my dad. And so I would walk up and down the street with an acoustic guitar, banging on it, singing songs at the top of my lungs, thinking that, you know, my dad was going to come find me as a rocker on the streets, right? And
my son's out there somewhere.
Right? You know? And I feel bad because I love my dad, right? You know, but
yeah, yeah.
You know, that's where my head was at. I was so blown away by that moment. And it was neat because all these years later, five years ago, we were asked to play that very stage, which was neat. We opened up.
Oh, that's really cool.
We opened up for Eddie Money.
A little bit
before he passed. And you know, just getting up on that stage in front of, we were the opening act. So halfway through our set, I think there were a little over 10,000 people there. And that's the biggest crowd I've ever played in front of. And it was just, it was just incredible.
I had to imagine that was kind of like a very special, almost like full circle moment for you.
Oh, yeah. I actually sat for one song. I ran around out to the lawn and then came back into the pavilion area. And I sat on the stage about where I was when that moment happened.
Mm-hmm.
I was six, just to say that I did.
Well, just to kind of feel that and like let those memories, I imagine, come back to you.
That was a big moment for the band because, you know, we had played some nice size shows. We'd opened up for the Verve Pipe a bunch of times.
Mm-hmm.
Up for Thriving Ivory and Ryan Starr. And,
yeah.
So we opened up for these different acts that were pretty cool, but we'd never done anything this size. And you know, the guys were, you know, Joel took it in stride. He's the guitar player. He took it in stride, and you know, he's just taking selfies out. You know, he was just really just taking it in as a happy moment. Now, David, our drummer, he actually, he didn't believe that we booked the gig, because we booked the gig maybe 9 or 10 months before it happened.
Yeah.
So he didn't tell anybody he refused to tell anybody until it was out in the papers that we were
putting
up, right? And so I want to say he waited like 5 or 6 months before he didn't tell a soul. And I said, why don't you just tell people? It's kind of exciting. And he's like, no. Because I just don't think it's going to happen. I can't believe it. I can't believe it. You know, and so he kept it quiet for about 5 or 6 months. And then when it came out, he just was ecstatic and all that.
Yeah.
So that was probably...
I mean, that reminds me of when you hear an interview with somebody who gets on like Saturday Night Live, and then they say like they won't tell anybody until like, all right, the show is happening and I'm going to be in the episode. So right. Now I can let people know to watch.
Yeah. It was one of those things where I think that was a turning point for the band.
Yeah.
You never know. Like, everybody wonders, do you feel any changes, right?
Mm-hmm.
We never felt any changes, but there were moments like that. That was a big moment, you know?
Yeah.
I can go back, opening up for Boxer Rebellion. Do you know mm-hmm. that?
Yeah.
Great. Awesome band. Super nice guys.
Yeah.
Playing, you know, opening for them, opening for a bunch of shows for the Verve Pipe. That was neat. But each time, you know, it's this wait in between, right? And you know, you kind of do your own thing, and you're kind of playing shows, and then something else happens, and it's a little more interesting, right? And so,
yeah,
that was kind of a turning point, because after that, we had all this good footage in front of us, in front of a bunch of people, right?
Yeah.
And so I took some of that footage, and I said, we want to get, you know. We want to get like a famous producer to produce something of ours, right? And at the time, I still am, the National, right? Mm-hmm. The National is awesome. And so I looked it up. I was like, who produces the National? I love them, right? You know, and I looked it up, and Peter Katus does. Okay. How do I get a hold of Peter Katus? I don't know how to get a hold of Peter Katus. So I wrote an email to his studio, because I figured out, it's not like he's in the phone book or, you know,
right, yeah,
online.
Yeah.
You can't look him up, right? But I knew that he owned a studio, so I wrote an email to his studio addressed to him, and I made sure to include footage in front of us, in front of a bunch of people, so that, you know, he'd maybe give us the time of day, right? He ended up being a super nice guy, but a couple weeks went by. And then I got a call from England, and this wonderful gentleman called and talked to me for about an hour and a half, and trying to figure out what's going on. It turned out it was Peter's agent, you know, the person mm-hmm. that schedules his gigs, if you will. And he was super cool, and he said, okay, I think we can work something out, but let me talk to him. I'll explain what's going on. And so, because, you know, it's not like we're rolling in dough either. You know? This is we're shooting way above our weight, right? And so he goes, you know, he calls me back a couple days later and talks to me about 45 minutes. And then he says, oh, and Peter said that you can move forward. And what are you thinking about? He said, we're looking at a 5-song EP, you know, and he said, okay. And I said, when can we get started? Well, we can get started on the first song right away. Okay, all right, great. So I sent it to him, and through talking and figuring out the direction we wanted to go, because we're in different states, kind of came to an agreement of the direction, and the finished product just really was cool. And so then I was all excited. All right, now we're gonna really do it. And then I got a call from Peter, and he goes, got some bad news. And I said, what? He goes, well, The National is recording a new album. I love The National. That's so cool. I'm so happy. And he goes, yeah, and you know, I'm producing it. It goes, but that's going to tie me up for like 8 to 10 months. And so I'm not going to be able to touch anything else for like 8 to 10 months. I said, oh, you know, it's taken me my entire life to get to you, right?
You're right, yeah.
So I'll wait. He goes, no, you can't wait. Waiting in this industry, that's not the right move. You know, I know that you're happy with the stuff, you know, but that's not the right move. He said, let me see what I can do. Let me make some phone calls. You know, I said, oh, okay, all right. So then a few days later, I got a call from that agent again. His name's Sandy, wonderful guy. And Sandy said to me, you know, I've got somebody I'd like you to just look into. Okay? Mm-hmm. And I think he might be a good replacement. I said, oh, you know what? I've been thinking about it. I don't mind waiting the 10 months. I'll wait the 10 months. And he goes, well, at least look at this guy. And I said, well, who is he? His name's Tim Palmer. I'm like, that's a general enough name that I didn't attach it to anything yet. I didn't know.
Well, and this is what I wanted to ask you about Peter Candace and Tim Palmer, because yeah, when I was doing kind of like research and like in who you'd worked with, and I saw the name Tim Palmer, it took me, but I was like, I know that name.
Yeah.
And I was like, right, he worked on Pearl Jam 10.
Yes. Yes.
And it's right? So funny, the names that you see just from liner notes and like, right, you know, they're not out there performing, but like they play such a crucial role. And then,
right.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, and to bring the whole conversation full circle, I went to timpalmer.com because he said, just go to timpalmer.com.
Oh, so I did the same thing. Yeah.
Yeah. And I went there, and with the, you know, I had hung up. I went there within 2 minutes of reading. I was back on the phone. You know, this, I think that's going to work out. I think Tim's.
Oh my gosh. The list of who he's worked with, it just kept going.
Oh my gosh. It was nuts. It was nuts. And so Tim is an amazing individual. He's awesome. Just an awesome guy. And, you know, he did Tin Machine by David Bowie. Mm-hmm. He did All That You Can't Leave Behind by U2. He did. I mean, he worked on so many huge things. I was just sitting there. The list just goes on and on.
And it's an amazing cross section of,
it is, you know, right? Like
U2, Bowie, Pearl Jam, but then like Avril Lavigne's on there, and
right, Goo Goo Doll.
Like, Goo Goo Doll. I saw Ned's Atomic Dustbin. I had Atomic Dustbin CD in the early 90s. Like, oh, my gosh.
I think he did the Everything Zen album by
Bush.
No, I'm sorry. Not Everything Zen. Now and Zen. Now and Zen by Robert.
Yes.
Yeah. And then he did like an Ozzy record, you know?
Yeah, I saw. Yeah, Ozzy was on there. And
it's just nuts. Like, the guy has just, you know, so at some point you realize you're way out of your depth. This was the moment that I realized I was just way, I shouldn't be allowed to talk to these people. You know, I was just like, they're on another planet. But it all worked out. And so then we did, we did 4 songs with him. And that finished that 5-song EP that I was talking about.
Yeah, I was wondering about that, because when I was looking at that EP, and that's a really good EP, but I was like, I saw Tim Palmer did 4 tracks and Peter Candace did 1. So that kind of explained the split. Okay, right on.
And then Peter did, don't feel too bad for Peter. He did all right, because with that album he did with The National, they won a Grammy. So yeah, you know, I mean, I get
got
it.
Got a Grammy on a shelf now.
Yeah, that's okay, Peter. Yeah, I'm glad you did that, you know. So it was just, it was incredible. And so now we've recorded some more stuff, and we've got a new song coming out called Souls.
That's supposed to be released soon, yes?
Yeah. We're looking to release it beginning of June, so that's coming up. And in fact, how do you send a link? Can you send a link on this?
I don't know if you can send a link, but you can always attach something like to the, you know, you've got my email, so you can always send something there.
For your eyes and ears only, but I'll send you the video for Souls. So you can
please do. I'd love to see it. Yeah. In fact, speaking of videos, when I was, you know, kind of going through all your stuff, the 89 Hours video,
Yeah, you like that?
I started watching that, and I was like, how, you know, I'm always curious about that part of it, or that end of music, like the sort of the visual representation. Like, where did the idea come up to just use Fear and Loathing footage and sort of play, have the song sort of play over like an alternate soundtrack?
You know, all right, so we were trying to figure out, because 89 Hours in Vegas is it's got an interesting story to it, but the lyrics and like what's happening in that song,
mm-hmm.
is encapsulated by this scene in that movie, right?
Yeah, where they're trying to check into the hotel.
Right. And so it fit together like a puzzle. Now we had to cut some stuff and like shoehorn it in to make it fit just right. But it works well. And, you know, videos these days, we're not trying to make any money from them. So I didn't put like an ad on it or anything like that. So it's free to watch and all that. So it's a free use type thing, but we just wound up liking it. And what's weird is, you know, we did this video and I look at Johnny Depp is all over the news.
Oh my gosh, I'm a school teacher, and like my students, like they constantly want to talk about Johnny Depp's trial. It's like, I was like, I can talk about Johnny Depp's movies. I don't know if I have a lot of thoughts about his estranged wife pooping on his bed, but
gosh, it's crazy. Yeah. So, but yeah, that's, you know, 89 Hours started out. I was driving in my car, and a local radio station that is now no longer exists, but
mm-hmm.
The name of the radio station was 89X, okay. New Rock Alternative, Detroit. Was here for like 30 years, just recently ended. And they had this contest. And the contest was, they were going to send two winners of the contest to Vegas for 89 Hours. And
what, like, why, that's such an odd time. I'm guessing it's like time between flights or whatever, but still.
No. It was for the, you get their 89.
Oh, because the radio station. Okay. I'm with you now.
So they said, you know, they labeled the contest 89 Hours in Vegas. And I was like, that's kind of neat. Like, I just, there was a ring to it. I was drawn to that phrase. And that's all I had to work with in terms of lyrically. Right. So, it was 89 Hours in Vegas. 89, and I love that. Like, there was something about that painted a cool picture, you know, and it was, I was able to tell a story pretty quick,
mm-hmm.
you know, been to Vegas a few times. So I was able to, you know, kind of come up with some material pretty quick. And before I knew it, we're in David, each of us have studios, and in David's studio, we started piecing it together and just like, boom, 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 boom. We had the song recorded, not the recording that you heard, but like a really good demo of it within a week.
Yeah.
And, just on a whim, I sent it to that radio station and they loved it. They gushed about it. And I think there might be some clips on Facebook or something like that, where I put up recordings of them just talking about it. They just thought it was the coolest thing that some band was inspired by their contest. And so then they used it as like the drop, you know, like for the,
yeah,
you know, like, oh, we're gonna have, you know, talk about the contest again. Well, they had now a catch, you know, they just played that, and it was just neat. And so their support was really wonderful. And so, yeah, we wound up finally doing a proper recording of it. And then we had Tim kind of work with us and create this cool single. And so that's what we did.
I really like the track. I love the video. And yeah, there's something about specifically the 89 Hours that kind of,
yeah,
gives it sort of like, there's something about like, why 89? And like, yeah, it gives it a specific feel. Yeah.
I know. I just, to me, I was like, okay, I thought of all the things that could happen within 89 hours.
Mm-hmm.
And so that's kind of how we approached it. And it really came together well. So,
yeah,
you know, that track means a lot to, I think, all of us. It's gotten a good amount of attention. And so we're happy about that.
You know? Yeah. I really liked it. I liked that last EP a lot. I'm, you know, just kind of preparing for to talk to you, just going back through and listening to stuff. I really, really liked the last EP. So I'm getting close to running out of time here, but I just want to talk to you. You've got a single coming out. You said June. Is there a set date on that?
We will be announcing within a week the date that's going to drop.
Excellent. I'm looking forward to that.
But yeah, so Souls is the name of the track. Sometimes we call it When Our Souls Become, but Souls, yeah, Souls. And what I'll do is I'll send you the video.
Okay.
So I don't know if you make a tag after this, but if you wanted to add a tag to this, you could add a tag on your response. Just be honest.
Oh, for sure. I'd love to hear it. And whenever we can even do something when you actually hit the release date to help promote it, I look forward to it.
Yeah.
So just wrapping up here, what's next? You got the single coming out. What's the plan after that?
We're playing a big show at the Dashboard Confessional and Juliana Theory. So,
Juliana, yeah.
Yeah, so that's going to be neat. So we're excited about that. Joel's been working on some stuff. David is actually located now in Georgia.
Okay.
But he's up here a lot. And so, we just continue that way. And we're trying to use Sonobus. I don't know if you're familiar with Sonobus, but it's a way of performing in different locations. And
yeah.
Using that and then just preparing for these shows. We talked about New York, Pennsylvania. We talked about going south through, you know, hitting the states, going south down to Georgia to play something down there. That'll be kind of fall stuff. I'm kind of right now working on another project and working on a television show because I act as well and I write. So I'm doing that quite a bit right now. But in terms of the band, we're getting really excited about some of the new material that we've got. I think Souls is going to be, you know, you said bands don't repeat themselves.
Yeah.
This is going to be your, this is going to be your Benz.
Excellent. I'll look forward to hearing it too.
Yeah. I'm not saying it sounds like the Benz. I'm just saying that, like, you know, that kind of departure.
Yeah.
Yeah. I think you'll find it to be a fun direction. Yeah.
Excellent. Well, I look forward to hearing it.
Yeah.
Well, we're wrapping up here. Robert, thank you for coming on.
Absolutely.
Talking to me today. I look forward to hearing the new song and, you know, keep us updated and, you know, we'd love to do some with you again.
Thank you so much. And you know what? On behalf of all the guys, we really appreciate the support. Do you listen to us on KWSS? What do you listen to us out there?
I mean, everything I've heard from you is just on Spotify, and then I've found a lot of, like, your videos and live clips and stuff on YouTube.
You're in Arizona?
Yes, I am.
Okay, so are you in the Phoenix area or no?
I am just south of Phoenix, yes.
Okay. Yeah, we played in Phoenix a couple years ago, pre-pandemic, that was a show by KWSS. I don't know if you listen to KWSS. Do you listen to
it? I have not, but I'll check it out.
Yeah, check it out. Yep. So we're played, all of our songs are played on there. So if you're in the Phoenix area.
I am. All right, man. Well, Robert, thank you for talking to me. I appreciate it. It's a great conversation.
Hey, thank you so much. And stay in contact with me, okay?
I definitely will, for sure.